It is absolutely vital that before you watch this part of the video, pause now and read Heidegger. I know it is a crazy read, but take it as a big challenge, right? Do not worry too much. Just try your best. It's only 5 pages. But again, pause the video now. Make sure you have given the Heidegger at least one good reading before you read farther. All right, so now, I trust that you did that. What we're going to do first here, as we get into reading the actual passages and sorting this through, and you'll find this to be fascinating once it all clicks, is we want to talk about this quiz. So I'm going to put a quiz up. Let's say I'll put it up over here. I'm going to put up this quiz, and I think you will learn a ton if you've given the Heidegger one good try of reading. This will reveal a lot of things, even though at first it's going to seem just strange. But here are our questions. Now notice the key to these questions, right? It says, how do these normally appear? Right now, I do not expect that you have the ready to hand and the present at hand separated at all. They're probably getting a little mixed up in your head, completely fine. It's the idea, not necessarily having the concept right, but I want you to get a sense of what this distinction means. All right, so let's look at our first list. Our first list says, which of these normally appear ready to hand? So, as with multiple choice questions always, the answers are at least as important as the question itself. So look at our items and notice what it's saying. Remember, phenomenology is the study of how things appear. And so we're not trying to be scientists. Even scientists aren't scientists, if you know how this works, right? They are not what you think they are. They're great, right? But it's not how you think it works. We are paying attention to how these things normally appear. So let's go one by one. So philosophy readings, right? The Heidegger reading. How does that normally appear? I would like you to do your usual thing of talking to me, whispering right to your phone or computer right now as I'm talking. How does the Heidegger reading appear, for example? What would you say? Now, if we're a scientist, we would say words on a piece of paper. No, that's not how it appears. When you try to read a Heidegger, it pisses you off. Maybe you see it as a challenge, it's confusing, but you would say things like that. How does it appear? Confusing, obtuse, strange, right? Cryptic, right? All these sorts of words, right? Not friendly, fine, good. That's how it appears. It appears as something convoluted, as something strange, something dark and mysterious. Great. Next. How does God normally appear? Now, here is where I expect some very different answers, right? And what I mean by that is I expect some of you to give some kind of answers, others of you to give other answers, and they're great, right? So some of you are going to say things like, God doesn't appear because God isn't real. Great, that's fine, right? Others of you will say, well, God is mysterious. God is invisible. And then others of you are going to say, God is always present, right? But, right, transcendent. God is spiritual. God is powerful. God is scary. All sorts of things, right? But still, we have. Now, here's the ultimate test. The ultimate test is, imagine this thing just suddenly appearing right here in my office. So, if we have a Heidegger reading appearing in my office, we would say, right, that is a trick to read. What if all of a sudden just God came in? God came in and sat down right next to me. Would it simply be, right, this normal sort of experience? No, right? I would either be screaming, right, or I'd be like on the ground. Those of you imagine that God appears to you all of a sudden right now, it wouldn't be, oh yeah, just God. It would be this crazy event. You wouldn't know what to do with it. Good. So we get the idea. Next, a hammer. How does a hammer normally appear? Now, of course, we're saying normally appear. A hammer doesn't normally appear in the hand of a zombie attacking you. How does a hammer normally appear? In its little slot in the garage. And so if I pointed it out, or if I brought it here in a normal sort of setting, right? Now, does a hammer normally appear in my office? No, right? But even then, if a hammer was sitting here on the desk, you would say, all right, he must have some project. It doesn't normally appear with me threatening you with it. It normally appears in my hand as I'm working on something or just sitting there in the garage. And how does it normally appear? The question is, what do you mean? What does it normally appear? It's just a hammer. Hear the key word. The key word there was just, meaning it's only, or it's not significant, it's on only a hammer. Good. That's the idea. It's a hammer. If I say, oh, check out that hammer, you would say, why? What's wrong? If I said, check out God over there, you would freak. Next, a woman. Now, this is a little stretch, but let me try this. How does a woman normally appear? And, hint, I will get as many different answers as I would with the God question, but notice what it is. There is a woman. What do you say? Oh, nurturing. You would say beautiful, alluring. Now get weird, mysterious, confusing, powerful, right? All sorts of things. It wouldn't be a woman appears, right? So here comes a woman. It's not like, just a woman. Forgive the sexism. But if a man appears, you might say, just another man. Those things are everywhere. But a woman seems to be more mysterious, more confusing, or more inspiring of our awe, respect, maybe fear. Get it? So what's the unique thing here? What's unique, right? The hammer. The hammer is just a hammer where the other things are mysterious. When they appear, they are not something we can take for granted. We have to figure out how to comport ourselves. All right, try the next list, right? So first list, just to be clear, the ready to hand is the hammer. Those other things don't appear ready to hand. They are usually present in hand when they normally appear. Next list. So which of these normally appear present in hand? Okay? A cell phone. Your cell phone. How does your cell phone normally appear? And there you go. What is the normal response? What do you mean? It's just my cell phone. If it's not broken or a brand new one, it's normal. How does it appear? As just what it is, right? When we're having a cell phone, when we have it, let's say right now mine's over there on my desk. I don't use it as much as you guys do, but if I'm using it or it's on the desk, it's just what it is. It's the normal thing. For you, it's just part of your hand because it's always there. On a date, you put it between you and your date because what's more important, your phone. Don't do that, by the way. It's just a cell phone. What do you mean? Here's my cell phone, right? Grab it over here, and you would see like, and? It's just a cell phone. Exactly. Next, steering wheel. How does your steering wheel normally appear? Now think about this one. Your steering wheel, I could ask you what shape it is and you would say it accurately. But notice for about half of you, if I said what color is it, you would have to think about it, right? Because you don't really pay much attention to it. That's exactly the point. If I show you a steering wheel as it normally is, right? You're getting in your car, right? I'm suddenly at your house with you, right? And I say, oh, check out your steering wheel. You would say, why? What about it? As it normally appears, it is nothing important. It is very important, right? If it was gone, you would notice. But it's something we don't think much about. It's just a steering wheel. Death. How does death normally appear? What would you say? It doesn't. If I suddenly invited your death into my office, oh, hey, look, there's your death. You wouldn't just say, yep, there's my death, right? It's so interesting to have it here, right? No, you would freak out, right? Death is terrifying. We don't know what to do with it. It is distant. Even if you're not afraid of it, it is still something mysterious, and it's not something you just welcome every day. If you do, right, then, wow, life is hard to live. Fine. Next, a pen. Same response. Oh, there's my pen. You would say, why am I paying attention to your pen? It's just a pen. How does it normally function? It's either sitting there, and then when we use it, it works, and we forget about it. So, what's the key? What is the only object here that is normally present at hand? Death. The other things are familiar. They are what they are, and we take them for granted. That's our normal experience of things in life. All right. So now let's start reading. So remember, we are trying to find being, and we're doing it phenomenologically, looking at the world as it actually appears. A couple things you'll find. When we're reading Heidegger, one thing I do hope happens, right? And this is interesting. Because I, for the most part, understand Heidegger. When I read it, right, you will hear my cadence I'm using. it will make a little more sense because I understand it. I mean, this is fascinating. I mean, interesting little tangent. Do you know that they've done studies and they've brought in students who don't know questions on an exam, right? They haven't studied or they haven't even taken the class. And when they bring in that student by themselves, right, they fail the test. But when they bring in that student, put them in a room full of students who understand the material, they do a little better. It is so weird. All right. So the other thing I want to point out is it's really weird taking notes on Heidegger because the important words aren't the normally important words. It's not just the big words that are important. You will see, even if you look at the way Heidegger italicizes words, he's italicizing words like un and is. So you will see me saying, ooh, the most important word here is already. Like, what? So don't think of Heidegger like you think of other, like, science classes where, ooh, the big words need to go on a note card and I need to memorize that. No, right? So don't just focus on the key words. You'll need to focus on other words. And again, like I said last time, imitate the weird spellings and the weird punctuations when I capitalize the word being in the middle of a sentence. Please capture that, right? So please be taking notes. And as usual, here's a key thing. In a philosophy class, you don't just take notes like you're doing PowerPoint. Don't just take notes on what I write down. This isn't about keywords. Take notes on what you're thinking, what makes sense to you. If I give a little story that makes sense, right? You like my zombies with hammers part of the story. Make a note of that. Pause and take a note on what you're thinking. What stories make sense or what you're thinking about while you're learning this stuff. So let's start reading at the very first line, page one, right? You see it says section number 14. So let's read there, and I'm going to be that annoying person that pauses the TV show you're watching all the time to point out stuff. I think you'll find it helpful and not annoying. So let's read at the very beginning of the Heidegger excerpt. Our method has already been assigned. The theme of ours is to be being in the world, and accordingly the very world itself. Okay, we talked about that. That's a little weird. We're trying to find being. We're trying to find being in the world. And eventually we'll discover the world, right? We'll see. That's mysterious so far. And these are to be considered within the horizon of average everydayness. Get used to the words. Are we going to another planet to find being? Are we going to go to a laboratory? Are we going to a chemical science engineering or a subatomic particle collider? No, where are we going to go? We are going to go to our everyday lives. We are not going to abstract from the way things appear in our everyday world. We are just going to finally, which rarely happens, pay attention to average everyday sense of the world. We are going to find being as it exists in the everyday sense. Good. All right. This is, let me continue, right? So these are to be considered within the horizon of average everydayness, the kind of being which is closest to Dasein. So two keywords there, closest and Dasein. If you are a very good student, right, and God bless you for this, you have looked up what a Dasein is as you read. Because why would you read something when just one of the first words makes no sense at all? Sadly, what you'll find, I am very glad you looked it up. It helped a little bit, but it didn't help a lot, right? You looked it up and they said Dasein is either existence, right, or something like this. Now, let's talk about this word and then talk about the word closest. Dasein is a word that is the combination of two basic German words, right? Da means there, sein means being. So Dasein is being there. Is that clear? No, of course it's not clear. Think of it this way. Now, oh, for fun. What a total tangent. What is most American babies' first words, right? What do they say first? Well, of course, right? American dads are usually vacant. They've left, right? I didn't. I'm a good dad, right? And so you're a single mom, and what is your baby's first words? Dada, right? Damn you! That guy's a jerk. He left you. Why is his name on your lips? What are they doing? They're just saying the easiest word to say. They're just saying da because that's an easy thing. They can control their mouths and they get fascinated by their little stupid baby mouths can say a sound da. What are they doing? Now, of course, if you're in Germany, what do you think your kid just said? oh, look over there. You think your kid's inquisitive, right? He's a smart little German, right? Because look at him. He's paying attention to the world. Look at that there, mommy. No, he's just saying duh, right? Babies are stupid and they watch you get happy. And so they say the same thing a lot. Okay, sorry. So Dasein is being there. But what is that? So we've got to look at it. We've got something that brings its being wherever it is. Its being is there. Here we go. A Dasein, here's Heidegger elsewhere, he says, is the being whose being is an issue for it. Okay, so let's unpack that. Dasein is the being that brings its being with it. It is being there wherever it is. So its being is its concern. What sort of beings, what sort of things, right, to use that phrase, bring its being with it? What being has its being as a concern? Here's a rock, right? There's a rock right there. Is that rock concerned with its own being? No. A dog, right? Is your dog concerned with its own being? Now, we know this is strange, right? But your dog doesn't sit in the back alley of a restaurant, smoke cigarettes, and give itself tattoos. It isn't listening to The Cure songs or The Smiths and wondering about its own death. It does not contemplate its being. If you ask a dog, if you speak and bark, and you say, hey dog, what do you want to be? The dog, if he could answer, right, dogs are great, would say, a great dog. And by the way, I'm nailing this, right? I know how to be a dog. But ask a human, hey human, what are you? Ask a young human, what do you want to be? And it's a disturbing question. Because it is the human that has its own being as its concern. What a human is a huge question. We appear on the world. This is something Sartre would say in existentialism. Existentialism is a humanism. Good essay, right? I can send it to you if you want me to. What is he saying? A human exists before it knows what it is or what it's for. A human, its existence precedes its essence. What is the purpose of a human? Who knows? There's the idea. A Dasein is a human because a human is concerned with its being. All right. Now, closest. Let's try this. A Dasein is a human being, so you're a Dasein, I'm a Dasein. But what is closest to Dasein? Now, again, you're going to get confused with science and you're going to say, oh, the world is an objective world. What is closest to me right now is my shirt. Right? Are these glasses? No. I want you to think about this. What is closest to you right now? When you figure this out, you might feel a little nauseous, so I am so sorry. But what is closest to you right now? What is closest to you as a human being? Here comes the scary part. I am. That's so gross. I am closer to you than your clothes or your skin, right? I am right there, like inside. Because this is what you're paying attention to. You are trying to figure out what I'm talking about. What does closest mean? What is this unshaven guy saying? You're trying to figure that out. So right now, my words and what I'm saying and what I'm doing are closer to you right now than your clothes. Remember when we did that little experiment and I just gave you some time to pay attention to what was happening in the classroom? You didn't think about your clothes, right? Well, right now, your clothes have kind of disappeared. Sorry, right? I am so sorry. I am not closer to you while you're naked. That's not what I meant, right? But you're not thinking about your clothes. You're not thinking about your chair or even your pen or your keyboard. At that time, I was closest to you. So notice, phenomenologically, what is closest to a Dasein? The Dasein's task. All right, we'll go deeper than that. Keep reading. We must make a study of everyday being in the world, and with the phenomenal support which this gives us, something like the world must come into view. The world of everyday Dasein, which is closest to it, is the environment. Now, don't mistake that for, again, being objective. He's not talking about the environment, not talking about global warming or trees or oxygen. He's talking about the workshop you're involved in. Your environment is the world that you're working with at the time. So right now it involves a screen in this video. For me, it involves these pieces of paper I'm reading from and me dealing with this camera that I'm trying to stay in frame. That is my environment. What am I paying attention to? What am I working on? That's what's closest to me. That is my everyday world. All right, so now skip down to after the break on page one where it says number 15. So look at this, right? And again, I think my reading it out loud might make it a little more sensical, right? So try this. The being of those entities which we encounter as closest to us, remember what closest means, that we encounter as closest to us can be exhibited phenomenologically if we take as our clue our everyday being in the world, which we also call our dealings in the world and with entities within the world. Sounded weird, but what is he saying? For me, it's these papers and this clipboard right now. This is how we can understand being in the world most easily, our everyday sorts of experiences with things in the world. Such dealings have already dispersed themselves into manifold ways of concern. I told you, already is the key word there. When I'm experiencing the world, notice, I've already got my tasks and projects assigned for me. When I am thinking of what I will need when I'm doing this video, well, I get those things ready ahead of time because those are going to be my tasks. There are an infinite number of things around me in this office, right? But I'm only seeing the things I'm concerned with because they are always already, notice that phrase, they are always already there because I am thinking about what I'll need. I am, this is way ahead, I have projected onto this little workshop I'm in, this little office, I have projected my tasks and that's the world I'm going to see. Okay, that was way far ahead, sorry, right? Let's stay where we are. The kind of dealing which is closest to us is, as we have shown, not a bare perceptual cognition, but rather that kind of concern which manipulates things and puts them to use. And this has its own kind of knowledge. Now, knowledge here, I guess we could use a word like know-how or competence. Now, think about it. When we are in our everyday sense of dealing with things in the world, we are not just staring at them. We are not looking at them like we would look at God or death in our quiz questions we just covered, right? These are things we simply use, and we know how to use them. When we know how to use them, we in a way kind of forget about them. That's our most general, our most ordinary sense of dealing with entities within the world. We just use them and take them for granted. All right, now, next paragraph begins in the disclosure, skip three lines, four lines. Such entities are not thereby objects for knowing the world theoretically. They are simply what gets used, what gets produced, and so forth. As an investigation of being, it brings to completion autonomously and explicitly that understanding of being which belongs already to Dasein and which comes alive in any of its dealings with entities. Get the idea? We are familiar with things in the everyday world. Right? I have a basic need. Let's say, oh, I've got an itch on my back. Oh, I can't reach it. Oh, what do I do? Oh, I grab that pen. Oh, there, that can reach that thing. Now notice, I have a concern. That concern is always already there. Oh, my back itches all of a sudden, and now the world changes a little bit. What does the world change into? It changes into, I need a back scratcher. I look around my workshop, my environment, and then, oh, what comes into the clearing, right? So these things, most of which I'm not paying attention to, all of a sudden I'm looking like I was looking for my hammer, right? When I'm setting up the tent, I see a back scratcher. Now, what is it really? Oh, it's a pen, but I am concerned. I don't just look at the world theoretically. Oh, look around, there is a pen, there is a pencil, there are papers. No, I'm looking for a back scratcher and I found one. All right, good. Very bottom, last three lines of page one. If we ask, what is being? Now let's continue. One may answer, things. With this obvious answer, we have perhaps already missed the pre-phenomenal basis we are seeking. For in addressing these entities as things, we have tacitly anticipated their ontological character. The ontological word, don't worry too much about it. It's about how things exist, what their being is. Really deep word. But let's not worry. We are dealing with average everydayness. If we answer that what is around us are things, we're treating them as just these objective concrete things that you should study with microscopes or something. That is not our normal comportment to the world. Our normal comportment in the world deals with things as we use them. It is not a bare perceptual cognition. We are not just standing back naming things. Right. Think of when you're trying to learn a language, for example. Remember that technique some people use where they put little post-it notes on everything and they put the foreign word for it? And so when they look at their table, they see it says tabla, right? Good, right? That's not how we look at the world. It's not conceptual. It's a table. We put things on tables, right? Can a table be a back scratcher? Sure, right? It's not just what it is. It's what we use it for. It's not a thing. It's a thing we use. So now we need to take a little bit of an aside, right? So here, we'll give you some traditional notes, right? We'll make a little chart again. What we are talking about now is how things in the world can appear to Dasein, how things in the world appear to us. So let's start with three basic ways. Things in the world can appear, and again, please pay attention to how I'm writing it this way because you'll get a different message. Things can appear as no thing. Notice, I didn't say nothing. I said no thing, not a thing. Or they can appear as resident, ready to hand, or they can appear as present hand. Let's start. Now, this is not a key thing we're going to talk a lot about, right? But let's just get the no thing out of the way. But it is interesting. What percentage of things in the world appear as not a thing at all? I'm not saying they're nothing. They exist. But what sorts of things don't appear at all? In this sense, we could do this test. How many things in the world could I take away and you wouldn't really even notice them? Right? They are not a thing. They are not something that generally appears. Now, of course, when I say that, could they appear? Right? Could they suddenly become something that is no longer nothing? They've come out of the dark, right? And they now appear. Sure. I can do it just by naming it, right? If I'm with you wherever you are right now, I could point out things you're not paying attention to, and then all of a sudden they're no longer no thing, they are a thing, right? They are now ready to hand or present hand, depending on what's going on at the time. But so notice, there are these things, we are not referring to them. So these three categories don't define the thing objectively, but they are talked about in the way they appear. So try a basic example. How many things appear as no thing as you're driving a car? How many things could I remove and you wouldn't even notice? Tons, right? Hundreds of thousands of things could be removed. When we're driving, we're paying attention to very few things, and we have to be a good driver. If we were paying attention to everything, all the things even just in our car, we would crash. We can only pay attention to certain things. Now we can start to imagine how difficult it would be to have certain little neurological or psychological problems. Imagine what it would be like to have fairly extreme, say, autism or ADHD. Here's what you would do. To imagine what some of these disorders would be like, this isn't exactly what they're like, but it's a good way to be empathetic, is imagine all of a sudden more things not disappearing that we're not paying attention to. So, if you were to take an example, how many things in the world, the things that are there, like in my office, books and desks and pens and papers and computers and so forth, what percentage of things around you are no thing at any given moment? Well, if you think about it, it's the vast, vast majority of things are no thing. You could remove them and we wouldn't really notice, right? Now, maybe I'd catch its disappearance out of the corner of my eye, but I might not because I'm not really paying any attention to them at all. At all. They are no thing. What percentage would you give that? 99.9% of the things in the world are no thing. We have to let them disappear because we're paying attention to our tasks. Now, imagine ADHD, imagine it being extreme to where just a few slightly more tenths of a percentage of them are still appearing. So when I point out my pen, the back scratcher, what did I do? Well, I forgot about it after I set it back down. But imagine that thing not becoming no thing. Imagine me putting down that pen and I set it over there and me not being able to forget about it. That would suck. Right? It would suck to have that thing still, there's that pen staring at me some more. That would be terrible. I need it to become nothing or no thing so that I can get on with my other tasks. All right. Sidebar. So now let's go to the ones that we are going to pay more attention to. These are my focus. These are why I love this part of Heidegger so much. Let's talk about the ready to hand. The ready to hand are the things we are actually paying attention to. Every once in a while, we'll pay attention to the present hand, but remember, at any given moment, most of the things aren't a thing at all, right? So they're no thing, we're not paying attention to them, they could just as well disappear. What we're paying attention to is the ready to hand. So this is the bulk of what we're paying attention to, this is our object. Now notice, it is not the majority of things in the world, it is a very small percentage of things. It is the task at hand at the time. All right, so let's talk about the ready to hand. So, reading question, right? How does your pen appear to you while you are writing? So if you don't have a pen, it would be great if you pause and go get one and write this down. So I'm gonna start writing something on this little fake board over here and you are gonna write it down. Good, here we is. Let's start defining what the ready to hand is. The ready to hand is, write that down. Now, as you're writing that down, how does your pen appear to you? Now, you're gonna cheat and you're gonna do something that's very abnormal. You are going to stop writing, start thinking about your pen or pencil, and you're gonna say, it appears blue, or it appears like this, it appears like a stick in my hand or something. No. That's not while you're writing. While you're writing, what appears to you? What appears to you is the forming of the words on the page. And the pen, what happens to it? It's in your hand. It is not no thing. If I took it away, you would notice because you're directly using it. But you're barely paying attention to it at all. You're paying attention to the task, but the pen is ready to hand. And what does that mean? It's taken for granted. Okay, let's read what Heidegger says about this, okay? So, I am in the second paragraph of page 2. Let's, again, get used to the writing. Taken strictly, there is no such thing as an equipment, right? It's not some objective thing, it's not just what it is, it's what we're doing. To the being of any equipment, there always belongs a totality of equipment in which it can be this equipment that it is. Equipment is essentially something in order to. A totality of equipment is constituted by various ways of the in order to, such as serviceability, conduciveness, usability, manipulatability. In the in order to as a structure, there lies an assignment or reference of something to something. All right, so try this, right? This isn't hard once you unpack the words. When you think of, and please make sure you're doing that, have a pen and paper and play around with it, taking some notes. As you're doing that, think of that pen, that paper, can only be what they are in reference to a bunch of other things that make them function the way they do. A pen is only useful with a piece of paper in relation to the ink, in relation to a table that holds it flat for you, in relation to the lights that let you see, in relation to the walls that make it so the wind doesn't blow away your paper while you're working. It is in relation to all these other things that it can do its job. It is also in relationship to your hand working the way it does. Now all of a sudden you're ready to hand chair, right? You see that, oh, it's important that I have this chair so I'm staying at this level so I can focus on this task. And all of these things work together in this sort of matrix to allow you to do that writing task. And now let's talk about the in order to's. The writing is an in order to what, right? Or even just think of that. The pen is ready to hand, it's an in order to. The pen is an in order to write. And the writing is an in order to what? To think. And the thinking or the writing is in order to remember, to form ideas. And the forming of ideas is in order to study or think deeply or to recollect. And what is all that for? Now notice, this is where things can get a little weird. Because some of you are trapped in this kind of robotic, I produce tasks thoughtlessly, and you would say this, let's do the short story, which is sad. The pen is in order to write. The writing is in order to study. The studying is in order to pass a test. The passing a test is in order to get a grade. The getting a grade is in order to get a degree. The getting a degree is in order to get a job. The getting a job is in order to pay for my cell phone, right? The paying for my cell phone, getting a job is in order to, you can add, rent, right? To pay for my car insurance. And all of that is in order to not be evicted. It is in order to be able to get to my job. wow, that is a long list, right? You are doing all those writings because you have all those in order to's in the background that make it the task that it is. There's a whole matrix of tools and a whole matrix of in order to's that define the task. Now, of course, I am hoping that that task has a lot fewer in order to's. I hope that you're authentic and genuine and honest with yourself. And so the in order to is, I use my pen in order to write. I write in order to think clearly and to remember things. And I remember things because I want to learn, because I want to improve myself and have a happier life. Whoa, wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't it be great if you were actually studying because it directly reflected who you want to be, how you want to improve, and what makes you happy? My dream, right? But I know that's not how it works. I know we're little robot Daseins in a factory obeying what other people tell us. Okay, we'll save that for later. Sorry, that was too dark right now. Now, skip three lines and let's read a little farther. This will now start to make sense, right? It will. I know the words are weird, but it will start to make sense. Equipment, in accordance with its equipmentality, always is in terms of its belonging to other equipment. Ink, stand, pen, ink, paper, blotting pad, table, lamp, furniture, windows, doors, room. What we encounter as closest to us, though not as something taken as a theme, is the room. And we encounter it not as something between four walls in a geometrical spatial sense, but as equipment for residing. I think as for working would be a better word there. Out of this, the arrangement emerges, and it is in this way that any individual item of equipment shows itself. Before it does so, a totality of equipment has already been discovered. Now notice all those words, before, already. The task, we've defined it before we start working on it. We know what the task is. We don't start writing and then decide, hey, maybe I'll make some words, right? Even when you doodle, you have some task at mind. And then all the tools are laid out in their little matrix of assignments to work together, and you have some in order to's in mind. You're writing in order to do a bunch of things. Now notice that last word. Equipment has already been discovered. Let's write the word carefully, right? Hyphen. What does that word mean? Notice what discovered means. It doesn't mean that you've found something. It means you've uncovered it. You've uncovered, by looking at what you're doing, you've uncovered all the assignments, all the in order to's to make that task meaningful. Why are you doing it? Oh, I can see why I'm doing it. Do I always see why I'm doing it? No, that stuff's covered over because I'm paying attention to the writing. And so what does that mean? That's the ready to hand. The ready to hand experience is the experience of things that are taken for granted and get out of our way. We focus on the task, but what's in the background of the task? In the background is the ready-to-hand pen. In the background is the ready-to-hand chair that allows us to sit the way we are. What is ready-to-hand? Why I'm doing it. I can't pay attention to all of those things directly. I'm paying attention to writing these words correctly, and so those other things must fade and become ready-to-hand. I am focusing on the task, and the tools must get out of the way. The goals must get out of the way a little bit, but they're still there. If I remove them, you would know. All right, so skip down the page a little bit. So now I'm in the middle of page two. The paragraph begins equipment. Go six lines into the paragraph that begins equipment. Now again, please tell me I'm not crazy, but I think this language will start to make sense now. I think now you see what he's getting at, and so let's get used to the language. In dealings such as this, meaning like the writing, right? Like using a back scratcher. In dealings such as this, where something is put to use, our concern subordinates itself to the in order to, which is constitutive for the equipment we are employing at the time. The less we just stare at the hammer thing, or in this case, the writing thing, and the more we seize hold of it and use it, the more primordial, that means the more basic, right? The more closely, the more easily. The more basic does our relationship to it become, and the more unveiledly is it encountered as that which it is as equipment. The hammering itself uncovers the specific manipulatability of the hammer, the kind of being which equipment possesses, in which it manifests itself in its own right, we call readiness to hand. When is a pen mostly a pen? When it's being written with. When is a hammer a hammer? when we're hammering with it. And that's when we could say we best know the hammer when we know how to use it and use it. Now, of course, are there levels of expertise and know-how? Of course. When I use a hammer, this is a terrifying sort of experience. I am not a carpenter. So the hammer isn't so familiar that I just grasp hold of it and use it, because I don't have the kind of know-how of the carpenter. Yes, I know how a hammer works, but I'm not comfortable with it. When I am hammering in a nail, let's talk about that experience. So I am hammering in a nail. Now for me, and now notice, don't be confused by these weird geographic words. For me, where is the hammer? In my hand. When I am hammering in a nail, right, what am I paying attention to? Too many things. I am worried about my thumb being hit by that hammer. I am worried about how tiny that head of that nail looks, right? Oh my gosh. And I'm worried about the hammer. And so am I comfortable? No. Things are ready to hand, but not in a way that gets out of my way so I can just complete my task. And if you were to look in slow motion at me with a hammer, it's so weak. What am I doing? I am slowing down the hammer as it gets closer and closer to the nail. That's why it takes me like 38 strikes to get the nail fastened into that board. Carpenter, though. Think of a carpenter and how much more, notice the language, how much more ready to hand the hammer is, and the workshop and all the tools are. Their thumb gets out of the way. They don't even have to think about it. And what do? They strike it once, get it set in there, strike it two more times, and it's done. Where, now notice the weird language, where is the hammer for the carpenter? For me, oh my gosh, it's threatening my thumb's livelihood. For the carpenter, the hammer gets out of the way. It is like an extension of their hand. Strike, 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 hammer's in, right? Nail is fastened because it is also ready to hand. Now, I am that way with pens because I use them all the time, and I just use a pen, I don't think about it, it gets out of the way, and I'm forming words on my page. That's the ready-to-hand experience. Now, read farther. So now, last paragraph on page 2. Let's see if you can get it. The ready-to-hand is not grasped theoretically at all, nor is it itself the sort of thing that circumspection takes proximally as a circumspective theme. I'm so sorry about those words. The peculiarity of what is proximally ready to hand is that, in its readiness to hand, it must, as it were, withdraw, in order to be ready to hand quite authentically. That with which our everyday dealings proximally dwell is not the tools themselves. Again, what we're most basically concerned with is not the tools. On the contrary, that with which we concern ourselves primarily is the work, that which is to be produced at the time, and this is accordingly ready to hand too. The work bears with it that referential totality within which the equipment is encountered. All of the various tools that go together that enable me to write and the purpose of my writing must all be ready to hand. They must get out of the way so I can focus on the particular task at the time. But how do they appear? And let's use that kind of visual metaphor language. Well, how do they appear? Think about it. How does your pen appear when you're writing down that line? It barely appears at all. Write that. It barely appears at all. It gets out of the way. It fades into the background of our task. The key is why? Because we're paying attention to the task at hand. When we are writing, the pen must get out of the way. The paper must get out of the way so we can focus on forming the words. Now, what is in the background? What else is ready to hand? The desk, the chair, our hand. The goals we have in mind, what our grade is in the class, what degree we're hoping to get, what we're hoping to learn, what our life goals are. That's all ready to hand too. What does that mean? We can't think about it directly. It must fade into the background so we can focus on our task. Okay, so now we're ready for my favorite parts, the present at hand. So let's go through the little exercise. Please start writing down the notes of what present at hand is. Let's start with our basic definitions. Good? Now stop writing. Stop writing that, right? I know there's a lot of text there, but stop writing. And now let's pretend that I'm that teacher. What does that teacher mean? Mean that I'm that teacher that's strict, right? The teacher that everything is based on the final exam, right? There's one paper and one final, no quizzes or whatever, and I'm really mean, and I'm just lecturing away. And keep your pen down. Don't type, don't write. And then I start writing all this on the board. And let me throw in some other languages too. And then I say this, if you don't have this memorized, you're not gonna pass my class, right? Fine, now, stop writing. The reason you've stopped writing, right, is because your pen broke. Now, pen broke, what do you do? Now, I have some of you, right, who are from another country, and you would say, oh, maybe I just memorize what's written. Wow, right? You're not from America. We don't use our brain. We use our tools, right? That's what technology's for, so we don't have to use our brain. And maybe some of you are from a very distant land, and you've done this. This is amazing if you did this. Well, I'm going to look at the pen, right, and try to figure out what's wrong with it. Amazing, right? Where are you from? What do Americans do? They have 40 pens. They go to Walmart and get 40 things so they never have to deal with a broken pen. They just throw another one away, great environment, right? And just get new ones. Anyway, your pen broke so you stopped writing. Now what do you do, right? Hopefully you thought, can I memorize this? Maybe you thought, oh, I'm gonna look at the pen. But that's not normal, right? But now, by the way, the pen is demolished. And so now you're, oh, maybe I'll get out my cell phone and take a picture. No phones in my class. Ooh, what are you gonna do now? Now notice what's happening. Now, suddenly the other students have become apparent. Now you realize that, oops, right? I am now paying attention to new things. Maybe these other students have pens, right? Now, by the way, don't you dare get into your bag, right? That looks like cheating to me, right? And let's say you don't have any extra pens, or they're all broken, right? I'm a terrible devil. Now you're looking at other people. When I gave you an ordinary classroom scenario, getting ready to read Heidegger, other students don't appear to you. Why? Because you don't need them, right? You ignore them. Now how do they appear? Do they appear as human beings with goals and ambitions and fears and desires? No. They're just little pen machines. They're little pen pimps that you're hoping to get a pen from so you can borrow one so you don't fail the class because I'm that teacher. All right, let's go back to writing, okay? So the present hand, how can we define it? Well, this is the appearance of tools that do not function. These are the appearance of broken tools, things that are broken or missing. All right, so let's write that down. And again, I'm that teacher, stop writing, stop. Please stop writing right there. You can always pause the video. Come on, stop. This time you stop for another reason. This time you stop because you just got a text, right? Now, do you always look your text? Yeah, it could be important. It is such a joke, right? You say you need your cell phone for emergencies, right? You need your cell phone because something might happen to your family. And then what do you do when you're with your family? All your loved ones are around you? You're still checking your phone, right? Who knows, Beyonce might have just gotten some perfume that I need to get my hands on. No, you check it. You'll be making love to your partner and text comes, you wanna check it, right? Gosh, that's awful. Anyway, so you're in the middle of this class, right? You can get in real trouble because the teacher's really strict, but you hear a text come in, right? What do? Secretly look at it. This time you've stopped writing because the text says this, right? It's from your mom. And it says, sweetheart, I can't believe it, but the doctor just called and it is cancer. It is terminal cancer, sweetheart. We will deal with this. Message me as soon as you get this. I love you. We will do okay. Now, I keep writing. I am that teacher, so I'm just writing, and I'm writing in Greek and German and French and all of these things, right? Because I'm trying to be over your head. I don't know why teachers do that stuff. What do you do? Now what do? It's too much to remember, right? All of this stuff. Well, now you finally leave. You get up and leave. Why? Because now you realize all the in order to's. Why were you writing that down? In order to learn, in order to study for the test, in order to get a good grade, in order to get a degree. You now realize that those things don't matter to you. You've finally seen them for what they are and you realize, why am I studying Heidegger? This has nothing to do with my happiness or my family's happiness. I'm going to die. Now, by the way, all of you are going to die. It's just a matter of when, right? But we don't think about the goals. All right, go back to the present hand. Let's read. This is now the first real indent on page 3. Let's go through it. To the everydayness of being in the world, there belong certain modes of concern, right? We care about things. We're concerned about things. We have tasks we are caring about. These permit the entities with which we concern ourselves to be encountered in such a way that the worldly character of what is within the world comes to the fore. When we concern ourselves with something, the entities which are most closely ready to hand may be met as something unusable, not properly adapted for the use we have decided upon. The tool turns out to be damaged or the material unsuitable. In each of these cases, equipment is here ready to hand. We discover its unusability, however, not by looking at it and establishing its properties, but rather by the circumspections of the dealings in which we use it. How do I know when the pen is broken? Only when I go to use it. When I turn it into a ready-to-hand tool for a ready-to-hand project, all of a sudden, the ink stops, or the pen breaks. And then what happens? I am faced with the present hand. The present hand is when the ready-to-hand no longer functions, no longer gets out of the way, but is in the way of my task. Try again. Skip 5 lines. Pure present hand announces itself in such equipment, but only to withdraw to the readiness to hand of something with which one concerns oneself, that is to say, of the sort of thing we find when we put it back into repair. Now notice that language. So I'm using my pen and I'm writing, and then all of a sudden no ink. What happens? I am faced with a present hand object, an object that isn't ready to hand, but I need it to be. And so maybe I scribble at the bottom, it starts working again. What happens? Phew, I'm not faced with the present hand anymore. I don't have to stare at this thing. I now just go back to using it. It is ready to hand again. It is repaired. Try another example. Go to the next paragraph. So now the middle indent on page 3. In our concernful dealings, however, we not only come up against unusable things within what is ready to hand already, we also find things which are missing, which not only are not handy, but are not to hand at all. Again, to miss something in this way amounts to coming across something unready to hand. So in this case, we find, oh, I didn't bring my pen. Or, notice the terminal cancer, my health is missing. My long time frame in which I had to get all these tasks done. I thought I had years. What's missing now? My health. The years, my future is now missing, and this is now present at hand. How do I look at things? I can't take them for granted anymore. Now I have to study them. I have to judge their worth. What happens when I give you terminal cancer? Who cares about this stupid Heidegger definition anymore? I'm out of here. I am going to... Now notice, when the pen breaks, I might look at the pen and see what's wrong to get it ready to hand again. But what might happen? Let's add to our notes. Very rarely, sometimes, this almost never happens because we avoid it. We hate these moments. But sometimes the ready to hand can reveal the whole world of our projects. Now we can define the world. What is the world? The projected tasks of all our projects. What does project mean? Not a project, but let's get under the word. A project. What does it mean to project? It means to put things out there in front of you. It means to project a meaning onto things because you have goals for your tasks. Your tasks involve projects. Now, every once in a while, very rarely, but I want it to happen more often for you. A present hand tool, a present hand task can reveal all of the ready to hand projects that are in its background. For most of you, your tasks are barely connected to your life goals at all. When I ask you, where are your life goals when you're in math class or when you're at your job? Notice that question. The answer should be, well, they're ready to hand. I am working towards them. Just like taking these notes is connected to me learning Heidegger and connected to me getting a degree and connected to me becoming what I want to become in my life. In math class and at your job, that connection is broken. You are not doing your job because it's directly connected to some lifelong goal you have. Go back to the carpenter. Let's try the carpenter. The carpenter, if they're genuinely a carpenter and not just a worker in a factory doing things because they're told, but they have, so look at that. They are fastening this corner with their hammer. Where is the hammer? Ready to hand in the background. Where is the bookshelf as a whole? Ready to hand in the background. They're not thinking of the whole bookshelf the whole time, but they can reference to it whenever they need to. Okay, this corner is in this situation. It needs to fit this dimension. Okay, I keep referring to that, and it gets out of the way. I do my little task. Where is the bookshelf as a whole for the carpenter? It's in the background. It's there. And what are the goals of the carpenter? A real carpenter? Perfecting this task, producing a beautiful bookshelf for myself or for my client, because those are the life goals. And notice, for the carpenter, there's not a huge long series of tasks that stretch out long into the future. They are a very short list of tasks. I'm going to fasten this corner, so I complete the corner, so I build the bookshelf, so I get better at this, so the bookshelf is beautiful and my client is pleased. And what are my life goals? Pleasing my clients and producing beautiful pieces. End. And those directly relate to his happiness, because that's who he is. He is carpenter. Being good at this is the goal. So try me. Try me. I am a teacher, like the carpenter is a carpenter. I am not doing this primarily for the paycheck, right? I am doing this because I think it matters. I think this will matter to you and make your lives better. So, give me terminal cancer. What would I do? Teach. I wouldn't say, screw this doesn't matter. No, I love this, right? I would keep teaching, and probably until I die. And how impactful would that lesson be? I am hoping that you get some of these lessons and you take hold of your life and make something meaningful and something you're proud of with your lives. Well, what if I die of cancer while I'm doing it? I use my last bit of energy to show you what the president hand is, and then I die. You gonna remember that lesson? Hell yeah, you are. Oh my gosh, I remember when my teacher died, and I remember that lesson. Oh, right? I don't want to have that happen. Exactly. But let me make this incredibly harsh. In your jobs and in your math class, where are your life goals? They're no thing. You're daydreaming if you're thinking of your life goals. They're not connected to your tasks. You're not doing this because you want to be a mathematician. You are not folding t-shirts at wherever you work in the mall because you love to perfect folding t-shirts. No, they have nothing to do with your goals. Your goals are completely separate. Here's a metaphor. A carpenter is building a bookshelf because they're a carpenter and that's what they do. Well, your job, you are hammering nails into a 2x4, not because it's some goal of yours, it's because somebody told you. You could be in the middle of an empty parking lot just hammering together 2x4s. It has nothing to do with your life goals. It's because you need a paycheck to pay for your cell phone. And does your cell phone have anything to do with your life goals? No. It's just how you cope with the fact that you have an alienated job and it's doing something because someone told you to, and you've completely lost sight of who you want to be.
Stop, what are you doing? Come on.
Can't find your back?
God.
Give me your wallet. Raymond K. Hessel, 1320 Southeast Banning, Apartment A. Small cramped basement apartment, Raymond.
How did you know?
Because they give shitty basement apartments letters instead of numbers. Raymond! You're going to die. Is that your mom and dad? Mom and dad are going to have to call up kindly Dr. So-and-so. Pick up your dental records. Want to know why? Because there's going to be nothing left to face.
Oh, come on.
An expired community college student ID. What'd you study, Raymond?
Stuff.
Were the midterms hard? I asked you what you studied.
Biology mostly.
Why?
I don't know.
What did you want to be, Raymond K. Hessel? The question, Raymond, was what did you want to be?
Answer him, Raymond. Jesus.
Veterinarian.
Animals.
Yeah, animals. So...
stuff. Yeah, I got that. That means you have to get more schooling.
Too much school.
Would you rather be dead?
No.
You'd rather die here on your knees in the back of a convenience store?
Please stop.
keeping your license. Gonna check in on you. I know where you live. If you're not on your way to becoming a veterinarian in 6 weeks, you will be dead.
Fine. Really harsh. Okay? When something ready to hand is found missing, though its everyday presence has been so obvious that we never take any notice of it, this makes a break in those referential contexts which gives which circumspection discovers. Our circumspection comes up against emptiness and now sees for the first time what the missing article was ready to hand with and what it was ready to hand for. The environment announces itself afresh. So what happens? What happened when I broke your pen? Nothing. You found another pen. You tried to cheat with your cell phone. You never got around to realizing what the pen was for, what all of this was for. You just kept hammering your 2x4s in the parking lot, not even realizing this had no connection to your happiness or satisfaction or to your loved ones at all. But when I give you terminal cancer, maybe then, and even then rarely, because you're still going to probably go on hammering your 2x4s, right, until you die, realizing that I never built anything. What does it reveal? In those rare instances, it reveals all of the projects. And so think about that case. The present at hand experience, right, let's be more academic, is looking at the world theoretically in order to fix it. It is looking at the pen, but notice how I look at it. I don't take it for granted. Now I'm concerned with its properties. Now I'm doing what you think is science, right? What are the materials? What is the ink? Do I suddenly notice that the ink is something mysterious? Yes, now I'd finally notice. I don't pay attention at all before that. But notice if I do this with your life. What you should do at that moment, if my hopes are realized, is that you would look at, say, your bucket list. What do I want to do? I want to have kids, right? I want to be this. I want to do that. I want to travel. I want to be happy, right? You notice that you're not working on any of those things. And so you would look at your bucket list like you would look at a broken pen and see what are these things for and what is their value. And if you have terminal cancer, the bucket list changes because you finally see it objectively. You're saying, I don't care about that. I don't want that many followers on Instagram. That is stupid. That has nothing to do with my life. Do I want that car? No, that's dumb, right? Why do I want that? I am going to die. I'm going to start traveling if that's what I want to do. I'm going to screw this Heidegger class. What do I care about this? Now notice, is that very bad marketing for my class? Yes, right? Wouldn't it be pretty cool if a few of you say, you know what? Screw it. I've always wanted to do that or go there. I'm doing it now. Great. Now, maybe for some of you, this class will help you in your life. Maybe you're seeing some of my lessons already and saying, I'm going to start learning from this class and really learning in the way that might affect the way I live my life. I hope. Others, no. This is my 2x4s. I do this class like I do everything else because I'm told to. But what am I hoping? I am hoping I can give you some moments of broken tools in this class so that you will see what these tasks are for. That's what I'm hoping to do with Heidegger. All right. So far this has sounded pretty dark, right? Well, it gets worse. Because it gets worse because we come to the they. Now, the they. Let's talk about that and let me give you a plot for a brand new zombie script that some of you are going to write. Okay, so here's the zombie script. We find our character and he is running from zombies, right? The usual start to a zombie movie, running from zombies, right? And there they are trying to get their brains. Now, this is a different sort of zombie plot though, because what do we find, right? As you're running from the zombies, you stop and you see a small child. And what do? You grab the small child, tear open its skull and eat its brains. What, right? You're running from zombies, but you don't realize that you are a zombie. So you are a zombie, but that's convinced it's the others to be afraid of, and you don't realize that you're a zombie as well. Now notice how this works, right? The they in German is das Mann. Now, German usually sounds all stern, so let's say it's stern. Das Mann. Das Mann is like zombies, right? Or here's another metaphor you can use. In the 60s and 70s, the Black Panther movement would say things about Whitey, and they would call Whitey the man, right? So you would have a reference like, who is trying to keep you down? The man is, right? That's a good reference. Das Mann is like saying the man, right? The man is what's trying to oppress you. But here's what's different is you're one of them. You're afraid of Das Mann. You're afraid of the they, but you're one of the masses as well. When you turn to your friend and you say, oh, those are cute shoes, what have you just done? You have just devoured her brains. You have just stolen those shoes. They used to be hers. Now whose are they? The they's. All right, so let's read. So now I am in technically the third paragraph on page 4. Below where it says the number 27, go 3 lines down that paragraph. Dasein's everyday possibilities of being. Notice what that is saying. The very possibilities of what you could be. What do you want to be, little kid? The possibilities are. Dasein's everyday possibilities of being are for the others to dispose of as they please. These others, moreover, are not definite others. On the contrary, any other can represent them. One belongs to the other's oneself and enhances their power. The who is not this one, not that one, not oneself, not some people, and not the sum of them all. The who is the neuter, the they. Now notice, do not mistake the they for politicians or the media, right? Even Instagram, right? Or your parents. The they is everywhere. And how do you know what the they thinks? You know what the they thinks because that's what you think. Your very first experiences of everything are how the they defines them. And that's the trick. You can't find they, except maybe yourself, and so you mistake it for your own perspective. The they defines everything. When I say, what is this? The they says, a pen. Because that is your first experience. Keep reading. Go to the next paragraph. The paragraph begins in utilizing. Go to the fourth line. In this inconspicuousness, now what is he referring to? The they themselves, they can't be found. In this inconspicuousness and unascertainability, the real dictatorship of the they is unfolded. We take pleasure and enjoy ourselves as they take pleasure. We read, see, and judge about literature and art as they see and judge. Likewise, when we shrink back from the great mask as they shrink back. Notice, we are afraid of the they, and so are the they. We find shocking what they find shocking. The they, which is nothing definite and which all are, though not as the sum, prescribes the kind of being of everydayness. So not only are you these people that aren't even paying attention to what you're doing, hammering your 2x4s, you're only hammering the 2x4s because that they told you to, and that's how you define yourselves. Now, some of you in your opinion papers, I asked you about what tech you buy and what you wear, and you say, I like the tech because I just happen to like it. I find it comfortable or attractive. No, you don't. You find attractive what the they finds attractive. At the very best, you define yourself in contrary to what the they says. Why do I like it? Because the they hates it. You're still letting the they denote the path, right? Your path is either what the they tells you to obey, or you're just disrupting the path. You're not on your own path. You're either on the they's path or doing the opposite of the they because you're a hipster or something. Sorry, I like the point of hipsters, but that is often as stupid as it gets. I hope they're trying to forge their own path. All right. So now go to the last 5 lines of page 4. In these modes, one's way of being is that of inauthenticity and failure to stand by oneself. Meaning, we're all fake. Our instincts are fake. They are the they's ideas. The self of everyday Dasein is the they self, which we distinguish from the authentic self. That is, from the self, which has been taken hold of in its own way. As they self, the particular Dasein has been dispersed into the they and must first find itself. Now listen to this language. If Dasein is familiar with itself as they self, this means, at the same time, that the they itself prescribes that way of interpreting the world and being in the world which lies closest. Proximally, Dasein is they, and for the most part it remains so. If Dasein discovers the world, notice, discovers the world, it's always there, you just don't see it. If Dasein uncovers the world in its own way and brings it close, if it discloses to itself its own authentic being, then this discovery of the world and this disclosure of Dasein are always accomplished as a clearing away of concealments and obscurities, as a breaking up of the disguises which with Dasein bars its own way. Okay, let's try a really stupid metaphor here. Let's say that you are going to look in the mirror. Now, why do we look in mirrors? To see what the they thinks. When we look at ourselves in a mirror, all we're really looking for is, what will the they say about what I look like? Oh, I hate it. I hate mirrors. Okay? Now, let's pretend you're going to look in a mirror and you're going to see yourself for what you really look like. It can't be done. Because when you look in a mirror, you see all of the things people have told you. You have told you that your nose looks like so-and-so's. And so that's what you see. You're going to see, oh, my forehead or my hairline is how that they sees it. What would it take to really see? And this is stupid. Who cares what you look like? That doesn't matter for your life and your happiness. But let's just say we're trying to do this stupid task of looking at ourselves in a mirror. In order to see yourself for what you really are, you would have to actively, and this is going to take some real psychological strength, you're going to have to remove all those concealments that cover up what is really there when you look. You're going to have to cover, you're going to have to remove the covering that says your nose looks like this, and oh, you have the cutest eyebrows, and oh, look at your forehead, and oh, look at your beard and what it looks like and what you're hoping it looks like, because what are you doing? Trying to imitate the they so they'll approve of you. Imagine the effort it would take to get rid of all of those coverings that make you see something that the they sees. It's almost impossible. And now imagine doing that with choosing a major, choosing a job, choosing a partner. Imagine taking away all of the things that the they covers over. It would take an incredible effort. You would have to trick the they in order to make a decision that is genuinely yours. Now, some of you right now are saying, right, in your head, maybe you're even screaming at the screen, I would love it if that's happening, right? Some of you are saying, no, but Jeff, I smoke weed or I do art or music. And I really get into it and I do things for myself, right? No, right? I am so sorry. It doesn't work that way. The world is simply the they self, right? It takes a real effort to break it up. Let's let Heidegger depress you. Second paragraph, page 5. This everyday way in which things have been interpreted is one into which Dasein has grown in the first instance, with never a possibility of extrication. In it, out of it, and against it, all genuine understanding, interpreting, and communicating, all rediscovering and appropriating anew, are performed. In no case is a Dasein untouched and unseduced by this way in which things have been interpreted. Set before the open country of a world in itself so that it just beholds what it encounters. When you smoke weed, you don't just see things for what they are. The dominance of the public way in which things have been interpreted has already been decisive, even for the possibility of Dasein having a mood, that is, for the way, basic way in which Dasein lets the world matter to it. The they prescribes one state of mind and determines what and how one sees. So you have to take that part for granted. You are going to have Dasein's experience as your basic experience, meaning the they's experience is going to be Dasein's experience. You have to understand that in order to break it up. So last part of Heidegger, and then a little postscript, right? A terrifying postscript. The last part is death. So now think. What are we supposed to think about death? Well, the they has already told us what to think about death, and that is what we think about it. Listen. So now I am in the second to last paragraph of the whole piece, midway down the paragraph that begins in the publicness. Death is encountered as a well-known event occurring within the world. The they has already stowed away an interpretation for this event. It talks of it in a fugitive manner, either expressly or else in a way which is mostly inhibited, as if to say, one of these days one will die too, in the end, but right now it has nothing to do with us. In such a way of talking, death is understood as an indefinite something which, above all, must duly arrive from somewhere or other, but which is proximally not yet present at hand for oneself, and is therefore no threat. Now, you get it. Your little kid, and of course you have kids, this is New Mexico, more teen pregnancy jokes, right? Your little kid has a goldfish die, and your kid has a real existential crisis, right? It's as if your kid is reading Heidegger and says, wait, if my goldfish dies, doesn't that mean you're going to die, mommy? Doesn't that mean I'm going to die? And what do? You do the they. You say, oh, honey, yes, everyone will die, but not for a long, long time. So don't think about it. What is death? Death is the ultimate broken tool. It is the ultimate present hand, because death means all of your projects will break. It tells you you don't have forever to become what you want to become. You don't have forever to do that thing, so quit putting it off. But what does the they do about death? Don't think about it. Now, what are the various ways we don't think about it? Because some of you are, say, Christians, right? And you would say the very same thing, just you think you have a trick. So the ordinary person says, oh, don't think about death. That is so macabre, right? Don't ruin my mood by talking about my death, right? That's the only way I could get you to see the point of you hammering your 2x4s, taking gibberish notes from a board that you would keep taking no matter what they mean. Death is the broken tool. Now, what does the Christian do? They don't take it seriously ever by pretending it's not real. They say, I'm not worried about death because I'm going to go to heaven. That is just another way for you to pretend death isn't real. Even if you go to heaven, this death is still real. These projects will still end. And so you don't take them seriously. You think, I have forever to work on my projects. No, you don't, right? That's just your way to avoid death in another way. All right, one last part of this. Now, let's do another little imagination exercise. Imagine that you have just been robbed. Imagine you come to your car and all of the things are gone from it. Or imagine, like this happened to me once, you got mugged, right? Imagine that things were stolen from you. Now, Heidegger can explain that all very well, right? Especially how the feeling of losing stuff, of having stuff stolen, gets worse over the first few hours. Because what happens, let's say someone steals your bag out of your car. It is only within hours that you realize how important all those tools were for your projects. You start to realize, oh, now my wallet's gone. Oh no, my credit card. Oh no, right? My ID. Oh, my social security number. Oh, and you start noticing all these things. Your phone is stolen. You start to realize all the contacts in there and all of the things, right? And so what happens? Well, we get this. Having stuff stolen is a broken present hand tool. You are now forced to see what the tool was for. That makes sense. And Heidegger explains that just fine. Now, let's imagine a different scenario. You are sitting there, right, wherever you are, and let's say you catch sight, let's say out your window, or if you're in some public place, you see a little child that is obviously terrified. You can see, let's say it's a 6-year-old little girl, you can see that she has been crying and she's scared. She's dirty, she's disheveled, and you can tell she has been crying and terrified. Now, let's see what happens to our world. Now, what happens to your wallet? What happens to your cell phone? What happens to your pen and your paper and your books? Now, what happens to that stuff, right? Now, at first you're thinking, well, now that stuff doesn't matter, right? Now I'm worried about this little girl, and so my other tasks have disappeared. Now that's smart, and Heidegger can explain that just fine, right? You would say, okay, I now have a different task. I'm worried about this child. Well, so far, good for you, but you still haven't figured it out. What happens to your wallet, to your cell phone, when this little desperate girl comes in? Wait for it. Some of you are brilliant human beings. And some of you have realized, right, that that stuff is now hers. That stuff has now not disappeared. It's now not unimportant. It's important because now I can use it to fulfill my obligation to her. She has now obligated me because she's in need. My cell phone is now something I can use to help her. That pen and paper, I can use it so she can write down her address or her phone number. Or maybe I can just ask her to draw a picture of her mom so she can calm down, right? Whatever is in my bag now are her tools that I can use to help her fulfill what her needs are. This, Heidegger forgot this. I love what Levinas calls it. Now, Levinas is really hard to read, but he says the obligation comes out of nowhere, right? The obligation just lands on us. We don't deserve it. The other person in need, and here's what he calls it. He calls it the face of the other. And he writes the other with a capital O, because it's not just any other, it's an other in need. And the other in need obligates us. It destroys, he uses strong language, it annihilates all of our projects because our projects are now devoured by the need to fulfill their needs. This is what Heidegger forgot. And this is what most people forget. Heidegger, some of you looked him up and you found out, sorry, right? He became a Nazi at the end of his career. He became a Nazi. No, there aren't any Nazi propaganda points in this reading. I looked carefully. There's no hint of his Nazism in this Being in Time. That comes later in his career. But Being in Time, this reading, can reveal why people become Nazis. It is not Nazi in its influence, but if you were living in Germany in 1941, would you have been a Nazi? Very likely. Being a Nazi was normal. Being a Nazi was how you got the best jobs, right? It was the political party that was doing the best and the most popular at the time. Being a Nazi was no big deal. What would you have thought of socialists and gays and disabled people and most of all Jews being carted off to concentration camps? You would have thought of them as background. You would have forgotten their importance. You would have said, oh yeah, I wonder where those Jews are being carted off to, but let me get back to my 2x4s. The ready-to-hand experience explains why people can completely overlook the needs of others. What happens to others when you're in a normal classroom and you don't need them? They disappear. The Jews would disappear for you if you're in Germany in 1941. Why? Because you don't need them. They're in the way. Good? The real experience of the other should be others obligate us. When others are in need, it changes the whole world. If you don't see this, then you let things like the Holocaust happen. This is what happened to Heidegger. Brilliant thinker, radically changed all of academia, but he became a Nazi at the end of his career.